Welcome to Words on Music with your Anchorage Symphony Orchestra. I'm Susan Wingrove Reed, the education consultant for the symphony and the principal keyboard player. And this is going to be a fun event coming up, our Hollywood Heroes Pops concert. Last year, we had such a blast with a tribute to John Williams. And this year, we're going to do a tribute to a whole bunch of different fabulous film score writers. Plus, you have to include a little John Williams and Star Wars. So to get started, I thought I'd talk a little bit about the history of music in movies, because that really sets us up for experiencing the classic scores we're going to hear from pretty much all periods of movies since The Silence. So the history of film scores is a fascinating journey. In live music was used with silent movies from the 1890s to the 1920s, and it was common with silent movies to use a piano, an organ, or even a small orchestra, matching music to the actions and the emotions, crucial since there wasn't any dialogue that you could hear. But in 1927, the volcano erupted. The movie The Jazz Singer, the first feature film with synchronized dialogue and a recorded musical score, the birth of the talkies, and musical was integral to what was to happen in the movies ever since. In the 1930s and 40s, the father of film music, whose name is Max Steiner, did a film score to King Kong that really set the standards for upping the game. He used an idea that Richard Wagner, the big opera composer, had developed called Leitmotif, where there's a theme assigned to a specific character or an event that recurs. And because of what Steiner did in King Kong, leitmotifs have become a favorite thing for film scores writers to use in their movies ever since. Bernard Herrmann is another important figure as we got into the late 50s and early 60s. He collaborated a lot with Alfred Hitchcock, and I'll bet many of you have heard or seen the film Psycho and the incredible music that resulted for that. In 1958, there was another key historical marker, Miles Davis. In the film Elevator to the Gallows, it was the first film that used a lot of jazz in the score, and it's one of the earliest movies that was created by an African-American film composer. 1967's The Graduate was the first film that used a whole lot of different licensed songs within the score rather than just the original music. And of course, a lot of us have fond memories of the song Mrs. Robinson, which was written specifically for the film by Simon and Garfunkel. The next epic event in film history in our short blitz here, it was in 1977 with John Williams and the first Star Wars film. And boy, was history made with that. Now, the process of putting the score together is kind of fascinating. The composer usually enters the process towards the end of filming during editing and sees a rough cut with the director and has as little as 2 weeks to do the entire film score or up to 3 months. The average in most movies is 6 weeks from beginning to end of the composition period. Once the music is outlined, then the composer either arranges it himself or herself, or hires an arranger or orchestrator. From single line melodies, everything has to be fleshed out into different parts for different players. And then a recording is made, usually with a click track, headphones worn by all of the players for the cue timing with the actual film running at the same time. Most films have 45 minutes to 120 minutes of music, depending on how much background stuff's going to go on during the whole movie. So now let's jump into a few highlights of our upcoming concert to entice you to make sure you have your tickets and you're going to be there to experience every second. We're going to start off with a piece that's by Elmer Bernstein, one of the classic composers who wrote Animal House, the amazing To Kill a Mockingbird, among many other classic films. And Magnificent Seven is the standard for Western scores. And we're going to play a suite from that particular movie. It's a blend of Mexican and American music, kind of Copeland-esque in style. And the picture was about seven gunfighters who are defending a village. Next on the program will be something by another epic composer, James Horner, who a lot of us know from Titanic and that epic experience, but also then something that was even more successful than Titanic was Avatar in 2009. The film and the music highlights a desire that we have as an audience to escape reality and connect to optimism and storytelling. He shared at one point that this was the most difficult film that he ever worked on. He would start at 4 in the morning and not stop until 10 at night. Sadly, although he was contracted to do the follow-up sequel to Avatar, he died tragically in a plane crash, but left us this unforgettable score. Master and Commander, which came out in 2003, is another kind of film score that's a little unusual. It's a compilation of original pieces plus classical music. Ralph Vaughan Williams' very lovely Fantasia on a theme of Thomas Tallis features the string section and was used in the film score. And when I was a high school student, I heard an Alaska Festival of Music concert in the summertime at West High Auditorium, and this piece was played, and it's been one I absolutely loved ever since. It is incredibly beautiful and unforgettable. This movie was an epic war drama set during the Napoleonic Wars, and it was adapted from a series of three novels about a ship. Russell Crowe was the lead actor in the film, and he had to learn to play the violin for a short performance within the film's score. And he said, "That's the hardest thing I ever had to do for a movie." Well, then we're going to visit the music of John Williams with his film score to Lincoln and a segment that is called With Malice Towards None. This film by Steven Spielberg as the director was based on a 2005 biography by Doris Kearns Godwin called Team of Rivals, which was an in-depth analysis of the final 4 months of Abraham Lincoln's life, where he had a vision of reconciliation and unity as the Civil War was coming to an end. With Malice Toward None and Charity for All was a phrase that he used in a speech at the time, where he was trying to bring a fractured country together in the final weeks of the war. The music we will share is a highlight, a gorgeous, noble theme reflecting this incredible man in our American history. Another of the musical scores featured on the first half is the film score to Wonder Woman, which came out in 2017, the music by Rupert Grigon Williams. There's a warrior theme for the warrior Diana, Wonder Woman, unforgettable scene in music, which I always obsess on whenever I'm thinking of the film, is when Diana crosses no man's land at the German front during World War I. It's an iconic movie moment and musical moment, visually, emotionally. And Diana is also beginning to understand, for the first time, some of her superhero strengths. Now, another classic film theme that we will visit at our concert with a lot of glee is Gonna Fly Now, the Rocky theme by Bill Conti. There was a boxer whose name was Chuck Webner, who fought Muhammad Ali in a huge boxing match in 1975. And that match inspired actor Sylvester Stallone to write a script for a movie that became Rocky and then a series of Rockies. The title song became part of 1970s pop culture when the character runs up 72 stone steps at the Philadelphia Museum of Art as part of his daily training routine. It still played this music at Philadelphia sports events. A New York Times critic referred to this music as a classic bit of movie music pomposity, but with a cheesy, inspirational appeal. We all love the Rocky theme. Now, another composer who I didn't know much about until I did research for this presentation is Michael Giacchino. He was fascinated with images and music from the age of 10 and did stop motion animation sequences practicing in his basement. An art teacher recommended to his parents that he attend the School of Visual Arts in New York City. And when he visited the school, he said, "Whoa, this is fantastic. They actually have colleges like this where I can do things that I'm really interested in doing. That was amazing to me. I loved it there. I loved the freedom. It was kind of like a great experiment. Okay, you're here because you like something. So let's see how much you like it. We're not going to regulate you very much. We're going to see how passionate and driven you are and how much you want this thing." So he majored in film production, minored in history, took an unpaid internship at Universal Pictures for 6 months. He was the only applicant. And he worked at Macy's to pay the rent while he was also still in school. Then he got contracts with Disney, Universal, doing video games. He did the film scores to Jurassic World, Planet of the Apes. You get the picture. So we're going to do some excerpts from two movies that he wrote for, Star Trek Into Darkness and Rogue One, A Star Wars Story. He also did film scores for Up, which I love as a film and for the music, and one of my favorite animated movies of all time, the Paris-inspired Ratatouille. You have homework if you've never seen either of those movies. The Enterprise sequel, which was Star Trek Into Darkness, was more dark in nature than the original Star Trek he had scored. And so he had to come up with new themes and new ideas. The Rogue One Star Wars, he was the first composer after John Williams to join the Star Wars family. And the Force was definitely with him. It's an astounding soundtrack, fun, epic, and emotionally. And he wrote it in only 4 weeks. And he also noted there's more timpani in this film score than in anything I ever wrote, and maybe in any film score in history. We're going to feature four classic crime fighters from television. I'll describe a couple of them to you. Mission Impossible, how can we not hear the Mission Impossible theme by Lalo Schifrin, was written in 5/4 time, and he humorously described it as, "I picked that time signature for mutant people with five legs." He said, "It took 90 seconds to write this theme, and I arranged it in 3 minutes, and it won the best theme in the 1968 Grammys." Another epic theme is Batman, 1966. Very cool story. 2 days before his high school graduation, composer Neil Hefti got an offer to tour with a band. He was fired after 2 gigs because he couldn't sight read music very well. But he then turned his style to playing, learning to read better, and Batman is probably his most famous creation. I love the fact that the words to Batman are literally just Batman, 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 over and over and over, then da, da, da. And so a friend of his said, "Word and Music" by Neil Hefti. Henry Mancini is up. Ah, Peter Gunn, The Pink Panther, all these classic movies, Breakfast at Tiffany's, Moon River. At the age of 8, Mancini picked up the piccolo of all instruments to start on. And he ended up then auditioning at Juilliard on the piano, playing a Beethoven sonata and improvisations on Cole Porter's Night and Day, which kind of threw the adjudicator panel that he got accepted. In 1943, World War II time, he turned 18. So he enlisted in the Army. He was first in the Air Force Band, then assigned to Europe, where he became part of a force that included the liberation of a concentration camp. When he returned to America, he hit the ground running for movie work and writing music. Peter Gunn is more rock and roll than it is jazz. There's an ostinato, a repeated pattern. He refers to it as obstinate music that is sinister and cool to hear. We're also going to hear a little bit more music by James Horner from the movie Apollo 13, quietly stirring and sweepingly epic. And then a score that I absolutely love by Ludwig Göransson, The Black Panther. He's a Swedish composer. He traveled to Africa when he was hired by Marvel to do this film to research traditional African music. So using a classical orchestra has always been a part of Marvel superhero music, but he also wanted to use traditional elements. For example, the talking drum that he's loved in the villages where he was learning about music from players there became a form of communication for the key player T'Challa, the panther. Marvel executives were wondering if the score was turning out to be too Western tradition and style, but he had to explain that music he had actually recorded by traditional musicians in Africa was co-opted by Western culture and was actually really African and not contemporary classical. To end our concert, we have to, of course, feature John Williams with a Star Wars score. Romantic era classical music with sweeping, memorable themes, breathing life into the characters we all love and the worlds of the universe. Williams influenced countless composers and filmmakers with his exuberant, wonderful finale that we will feature at the concert, which will send you out smiling as we're facing darker days as we lose the sun. I guarantee you're going to have an amazing time at our Hollywood Heroes Pops. Look forward to seeing you there. And here's to all the music with your Anchorage Symphony Orchestra. Thanks for your support.